we're at a brewery. There's 40 to 50 VW buses sitting in the parking lot. Everybody's drinking beer. Yeah. And we're like, how is not one of these buses serving a beer? And because of my work history in the restaurant catering concession world, thinking of something outside the box that was really cool, that was mobile to bring to people, bring to events, that we're not just stuck in one spot, that kind of spawned the whole idea.
I actually thought he was crazy.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I mean, he wanted to put the two things that we were seeing together in one. So we were at a brewery, but if you wanted a beer, you got to walk inside, you know, in line, order your beer, come back outside to take a look at the buses. And he loves VW buses, so he's like, why don't we put one and two together? And it literally happened that way. That was the last day in Colorado. We came back home that day. It was an 11-hour drive, more or less. Mm-hmm. And while he was driving, I was looking for buses for sale in the area. And then we switched and I started driving and he started making appointments. So the same day that we were coming back, we were already getting some arrangements to go see some buses. So it really hit us. Right there and then, like, why, like, it was a question, why there is no one doing it?
So you're on the way back to Texas, and you're searching for VWs.
Yeah, looking for crazy stuff on Craigslist.
Right. And then boom, you find one.
And find one in Arlington.
Yeah.
A guy named Mick.
Yeah.
Old hippie. And, but we didn't tell Mick what we were gonna do with his bus. Because we felt like he was a little bit emotionally tied to it. And we just didn't want him to know that there could have been a possibility where some cuts could have been made on the design. But we really, once we got it, we were like, let's not, let's keep the integrity of the bus.
Gotcha.
And let's really come up with a design where if you look inside, it looks like you can jump in and go on a ride. You don't have a bunch of kegs in your way. You don't have a bunch of equipment in your way. Mm-hmm. No, you can sit inside and go for a cruise.
Yeah.
So, you know, we came up with that cool design, got it from Mick, wasn't running. The body shop guy that was gonna do the restoration had ants in his pants. He's like, man, I'm ready to start working on this thing. And I was like, look, it's not running. He goes, well, I got a trailer. Let's go pick it up. So we literally called Mick and I was like, look, Mick, you don't have to fix it. I was like, we'll figure it out. We're coming to get it. Went, picked it up. Four of us loaded it onto a trailer, took it straight to the paint shop. Boom.
And it was a pea green color.
Pea green.
Yeah.
So totally. It was cool. It was cool looking, but not for our brand. So we just wanted something to really fit our brand.
Yeah.
2.5 months later, it rolled out of the body shop.
With the name Bubble Bus, especially with it, you know, coming out, you know, it's green and all that stuff. Like, tell me how you guys came up with that name.
So Bubble Bus Co. Came from, you know, everything that we serve pretty much has bubbles. So it's like the bubbles for the adults.
Yeah.
So you serve beer, it has bubbles. You serve champagne and it has bubbles. And of course we have other things that don't have bubbles, but
even the cocktails we do, like the spiked strawberry lemonade or just regular strawberry lemonade, we condition it so it has bubbles in it.
Yeah, yeah.
And so when people, they taste it and it gets them a little bit and they're like, oh wow, this is really good. So.
Well, there is something else. So there is a song that I didn't even know about it. He introduced me to that song and it says, what is it?
The bubble butt song.
Bubble butt. Bubble butt. So it was
one of my all-time favorites.
Have you seen the video?
Oh yeah.
It'll change your life.
So it was kind of like catchy. Like the name was catchy, and it was his idea, the name, and I was like, okay, we did our search, and Bubble Butt Co. was the name.
We always made jokes that we were gonna roll up to the event with the song blasting through a huge speaker, just so everybody knew that we were there. When we initially came up with the business idea, we were so focused on taking care of adults. And it's so funny how one comment completely shifted to making sure that we're taking
the
care
entire
of kids
family.
Too, the entire family.
Yeah, 100%. So you guys, August, you have this idea, 2019. Mm-hmm. 2 months later, you got it running. You've got the name. You've probably at this point changed the color to the beautiful color it is.
Yeah.
When did you actually start the business, and how did, like, was it literally early 2020? Talk to me a little bit about that.
In November, we had a couple of events, very small events, mostly friends that were, you know, like kind of supporting us, right?
Yeah.
And then, of course, December, January was very cold, so people wouldn't like to be outdoors that much. But we were booking events for March, April, May. Basically, this year, we were getting quite a few bookings. And then, of course, COVID-19 came around in March, and pretty much the first week we started getting phone calls and emails, either postponing the events or canceling. So it was a big hit because we had just started with this business, right?
Yeah.
And we couldn't really feel like we had launched it.
Yeah.
So one day we were sitting in the front of our house and just very bummed. He had lost the job that he had recently been hired at, and I work at events, so I pretty much didn't have anything to do either. And he told me this, and I thought, again, this is a crazy man that I married. So he said, well, I feel like, I don't know, I just want to go raise spirits to our neighbors. And I was like, what are you talking about? Raising spirits? And he's like, yeah, I wanna go serve them free beer. Let's just like get some beer, put it in the bus, and drive like an ice cream truck. And I was like, you're crazy, but let's do it. So I sponsored the first neighborhood, which is our neighborhood. We made a comment, an urgent alert in next door, and everybody got that alert, of course. So we started driving at 5 p.m. and it was amazing. That day was amazing because we saw so many families waiting for us right outside their homes with chairs, kids, dogs, everybody. And whenever we would turn around the corner, they would just like, oh, bubble bus, bubble bus. So we would just honk and like make them really excited. And that day, it was just about raising spirits, right?
Yeah.
And our neighbors were like, okay, how much is it? We were like, no, it's free. We're raising spirits. They're like, wait, no, how is that possible? No, take this. And we were like, no, it's okay. And we didn't have a tip jar. So they started putting the bills inside the bus through the windows. So when we got home that day, we finished actually very late, right? We finished like around 9.
Yeah, it was, everybody just wanted to stop and know what our story was. What do we do? Like every little house, we literally had a 5-minute conversation with people.
Yeah.
And one of our challenges that day was to make sure that we were able to get everyone in the neighborhood.
Yeah.
In fact, we had text messages coming to our phone. Hey, we're here at 2121 Kilpatrick waiting for you. And like literally we would make special trips to people's houses that we didn't make it to. Like if there were people there waiting, we got back, we thought we were done. I got a text, there was people hanging out down
just
the street.
Just waiting for
and
us.
So we hopped in the bus and went over there and took care of a family.
So that night when we came back home, you know, we opened the door and there were all these bills in the floor of the bus. So we picked it up and I asked him, so now what do we do with this? And he goes, well, let's pay it forward. That's where the pay it forward was born. So the very first day, it wasn't a paid forward. It was more like, let's raise spirits to our neighbors. But because our neighbors are so awesome and they decided to, like, you know, tip us, we used those tips to buy more beer and popsicles, and we did the first contest. And that's how, in fact, at the beginning, it was called the Quarantine Pay It Forward, because everybody was quarantined. When we started doing the Pay It Forward, people started noticing us. They didn't know about us. Yeah. So when we would go to a neighborhood, the experience was so awesome for them to be able to connect with other neighbors and to be outdoors finally after so many days of being indoors, that they would call us back for even just a party of 8 people. We have had events of just 8 people. Mom, dad, kids, grandma, grandpa. And what are they celebrating? Nothing. They just want us there for fun. Or we have, you know, the wife that wanted to surprise her husband, and, you know, we still couldn't have, you know, parties or big gatherings. So what she did is she hired us to go back this time for a private event, and she called all her husband's friends, and they all, you know, like, drive by and stop for a beer, and that's how we started doing business.
We take the tips from other neighborhoods.
Yep.
And basically we do an online social media competition through Instagram and Facebook, create a really cool video marketing piece, and we say who wants free beer and popsicles. And those neighborhoods that have the most representation, those are the ones that win.
It's a beautiful bus itself, but I think the coolest thing is the beautiful people behind it and the beautiful thing they're doing for our community.
Well, I first saw them on Facebook, and yeah. I thought that their little idea of Pay It Forward was so awesome, and just their hearts are so kind. You can tell that they're great people, and I just love the idea of it all.
Man, they got such a unique thing going on right now, and just kind of bringing the community together. It's just, you know, not taking any and all tips, just hopefully pay it forward, send it to maybe back to my parents' neighborhood. Yeah. That'd be sweet, yeah.
When they came, the response was overwhelming. A lot of people were just very charitable. I think that the tips were good, and it's so awesome to think that the next neighborhood benefited from that. And just to keep it going.
A cool story that has come out of this and that has sparked generosity out of people is the first contest we did, our neighborhood's tips paid for one neighborhood. But it's to the point now where we are able to collect enough money and tips. When we do one contest, we're going out and we're doing three
multiple
neighborhoods, four neighborhoods. So that's kind of cool. So we take our top two winners, you know, number one, number two, this is where we're going for sure. And you know what? We're going to do a random drawing for number three or four. We take our top 10 or top 20 neighborhoods. We'll do a random spin. And if whoever gets chosen, that's where we go.
When you're told that you feel that someone else that you don't know actually gave you that beer, it hits them differently. And another thing is how we are so in need of socializing, even though right now the social distance is a big thing, but we need it. We need it. We need to talk to people. Even if we have to keep our distance, if we have to wear our mask, the people after the events, they come to us or they send us messages saying, thank you. Thank you, because in the many years that I have lived in this neighborhood, I never met this person that lived right across the street from my house. So thanks to you today, I met them. Thank you. So connecting, we change our mission, actually. So initially we were doing just business, but right now we feel that we actually have a mission, and it's connecting neighbors, neighborhoods, and cities through happiness on tap.
I think we're gonna continue to move forward with these type of neighborhood events, because once things do get back to normal, which I do think is gonna be a long
normal
time, I feel like that we bring something that no one else has, like the vibe that we bring to the neighborhood. What's cool is that the parents can round up the dog, the kids, they can come get a beer, the kids get a popsicle, the dog can come get a dog collar. But what's cool about it is the parents don't have to worry about, I'm gonna go enjoy a couple drinks with friends at the bar, I need to find a babysitter. Oh no, we don't even have to hop in the car, we can walk down the block, grab a couple beers, hang out with neighbors, with the kids, let them eat popsicles, we can drink the beers, and
no driving.
I feel like it's something that will never be lost once we move past this. I still think it's an experience like no other. Yeah. So, and just the joy that we put on people's faces when we come, I don't think that's, you know, we're not gonna move away from that. And it's kind of cool, like, because sometimes kids will walk up to get a popsicle and they'll drop like, you know, a dollar or something in the tip jar. And I'll tell them, hey, let me tell you something. And they kind of look at me, you know? And I said, that dollar, that's gonna help me get a popsicle for a kid in another neighborhood. And so when they're young and like they start hearing things like that, that's what, you know, that's something that they're always gonna remember. Even if they're 5 or 6 years old, they're gonna grow up to be 30 and one day they're gonna be like, you know, some crazy guy told me that my dollar tip was gonna buy another kid a popsicle. And you know what, that's true. I saw him or heard about him going out and giving more popsicles out. So that's what's really cool. Is pretty amazing.
And I would say that sometimes you're in this position in life, like we both were without jobs, and you know, he got fired the day that the quarantine was issued, I think. And for a month and a half, we were just like not knowing what the future was holding. But we always kept ourselves positive and knowing that we have each other and we will get through this one way or another. And one single thought that came out of his heart is what got us here where we're now. So sometimes you think about, okay, not why this happened to me, like why did I lose my job, why this, but what for? Because we did have this conversation, and he said, if they wouldn't have not fired me, then we wouldn't be doing this.
Yeah.
And it is so true. Because if he was working, he didn't have time to do this. And I was not gonna be able to do it on my own. So, you know, not why this happened to us, it was what for.